بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. And last week we finished up by explaining the ayat in where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about and depicted to us a type of people that will come on the Day of Judgment, and He described them as wujuhun yawma'idhin khashi'a. And these were the people of the hellfire, and Allah Azza wa Jal went on to explain the depth of punishment and the torture over the torture that they will receive. So now the surah takes a turn depicting the other kind of faces. And so Allah Azza wa Jal says, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاعِمَةٌ. And already we said at the beginning, when the word wujuhun came without alif lam, instead of saying al-wujuh, when Allah said wujuhun, it already indicated and it implied some faces. And when we say some, in other words, there is another group. Now this is the other group that Allah is speaking about, and this is the group of the believers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among them. And then wujuhun, because it has a two bumma on the hat, and the tanween lit-ta'zim. These are things you should know now. Tanween lit-ta'zim. That when there's a tanween, it implies greatness. So in other words, this other group, they're going to be a lot as well, and they're the followers of the prophets. Wujuhun yawma'idhin na'imah. Yawma'idhin, on that day. And because yawma'idhin comes straight after, and usually in Arabic, this yawma'idhin is supposed to come at the end. Wujuhun na'imatun yawma'idhin, that's normal. But because it's come before, it's come in the middle, then this implies that especially on that day, they are going to be na'imah. Especially on that day. So that means not now, they won't be na'imah now. On that day there will be na'imah. And na'imah, before it was khashi'a, which was the description of the kuffar. Now it's na'imah, which comes from the word nu'uma. And nu'uma means softness, ease, relaxation, happiness, freshness. The face will be fresh, it'll be lit up. There's no tiredness and exhaustion on the face. Basically, nu'uma is a face that has just been given a gift. That's how the face will be. And Allah Azza wa Jal is saying on that day, yawma'idhin, which implies that it's not the case now. Now they will have to put in a lot of effort. And they have to give their lives and their wealth in toil and hardship for now. And it's not going to be easy. And they won't have relaxation here. So you have an interesting contrast here. You have people that are working really, really hard, but in the wrong direction. And they will wake up on the Day of Judgment exhausted. عَامِلَةٌ نَاصِبَةٌ. And on the other hand, you have those who worked for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and exhausted themselves for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they will wake up on the Day of Judgment fresh and relaxed. No exhaustion on them whatsoever. And you know, when you're fresh and you've just relaxed and you've rested, you're ready to work. And instead of having more work for these believers, now there will be more relaxation and relaxation and pleasure upon pleasure. And on the other hand, when you're tired and you're exhausted, you just want to rest. But for the disbeliever, that's not the case. It's just going to be more work ahead of them. تَصْلَى نَارٌ حَامِيَةٌ تُسْقَى مِنْ عَيْنٍ آنِيَةٍ لَيْسَ لَهُمْ طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ ضَرِيعٍ, and so on. Then Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ. Why are the faces na'imah? Why are they fresh? Why are they happy and relaxed? لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ. It is only because of their sa'i, because of their effort, they are pleased. Now the word sa'i, in Arabic it's used and it means a fast-paced walk. Right, for example, you say a sa'i bayna al-safa wal-marwa. When you go to Hajj or Umrah, there is the sa'i. And there's a part of it where you have to sort of pace walk, you got to rush. That's a sa'i. it's sort of like when you have a deadline on a project and you're quickly trying to complete it. That's sa'i. There's sort of a sense of urgency and a panic when you're really concerned about finishing a task. This is sa'i. For example, we have, and we read before in Surat al-Nazi'at about Fir'aun, ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى, that he turned and he started pacing. Why? Because after he seen the magicians make sujood to the Lord of Musa and Harun, and he began to realize he's been defeated, and everyone is starting to make sujood, and everyone began to realize Fir'aun is a liar, he panicked. There was some sense of panic inside of him. So أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى, he started pace walking up and down, you know, just like a coach when he's in the room and his team is losing. What does he do? He's got the and he's walking up and down in the room up there. So this is the same thing that happened. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى, similar to it, Fir'aun was doing this out of panic. And why I'm sharing this with you, because I want you to illustrate the word sa'i is not just a casual sort of effort you put. It's effort that you put with a sense of urgency and panic. So in other words, these people that are fresh faces on the Day of Judgment and they're lit up, which are the believers, they are going to be pleased, radiyah, they're going to be content and so happy with the efforts they had made eagerly and consistently with a sense of urgency in this dunya. So sa'a, lisa'iha, it implies this sense of urgency. They put their efforts and their energy in their work. And they felt that we're running out of time and we need to do as much as we can and put as much effort as we can in this life so we can see our reward on the Day of Judgment. So they will be pleased with their efforts on that day. And what efforts are we speaking about? In the previous surah, Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. These are the efforts. The effort that you put in cleaning, cleansing yourself, cleansing your habits and your character, becoming a better person, that requires effort. You know, وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ, and then the effort you put in remembering Allah Azza wa Jal's name consistently, that takes effort. And then the effort that you put in your salat, the effort that you put towards giving a sadaqah, the effort that you put towards staying away from the haram, and the efforts that you put towards spreading this deen. And these people, these believers, they had and they made other efforts. They had work commitments, they had efforts in their business, in their work, in their houses. But that doesn't even come to their mind on that day. You know, it's like those things that they used to do, the efforts they used to do in this world, they don't even count on the Day of Judgment. Right now, these efforts that you and I do, it counts a lot. Work effort and so on, it counts a lot. But on that day, it's like, you know, what was all that about? Why did I waste my time in doing such and such? And يعني, subhanAllah, al-Alusi here, rahimahullah, he comments and he says beautifully, when these faces see the reward of what they had done, they will wish they had done everything in their life for such a great reward. In other words, they will wish that they had no other project in this life except working towards the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal so they can see this reward. لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةً. And then Al-Alusi says, and the reality is that when they were in this dunya and doing work for the akhirah, they had to force themselves and they had to struggle. لِسَعْيِهَا, right? You had to force yourself and you had to struggle to do good. Like for example, you force yourself, come on, let me get up and go to the masjid and pray. Or you know, you sit down, you maybe get tired in the lesson, and then you just force yourself. Let me just sit to the end of the lesson, right, so I can get that barakah and get that reward. So this is لِسَعْيِهَا, it's effort. And Al-Alusi rahimahullah is saying that it's not easy. And you know, doing work for this dunya is easy compared to doing work for the akhirah. Like for example, a friend of yours will call you, he'll say, come on, I'll come pick you up and we'll go to the masjid, we'll pray together. Or we'll attend a lesson together. And he replies, nah, Allah, I'm feeling sick and lazy, I'm a bit tired. Then his other friend calls him, you want to go watch a movie? Yeah, let's go. You know, quickly he gets up and it's like there's nothing, it's all good. And the movies could be probably half an hour further than the masjid. But it's all good because it's for this here, efforts in this life is very easy. Another example, like you'll have a fundraiser, for example. This is something else that you'll struggle to do. There's a fundraiser for a masjid, you know. Brothers, please pay $20 before you leave the masjid. We're trying to contribute to build the masjid. All of a sudden, you become an expert accountant. Your expenses come right before you, and you start thinking, oh Allah, I got school fees, you know, I got rent to pay. And then you see your phone and your wife has messaged, don't forget milk and bread. You know, bankrupt. And you gotta pay petrol, subhanAllah. Ash-shaytan yu'idukum al-faqr. This is the devil, the shaytan, he's the one that promises you poverty. He'll tell you, Allah, you'll become poor, don't pay. And subhanAllah, you'll leave the fundraiser, you'll leave the masjid, and on your way out, you know, you'll turn, you'll go to Coles, and you know how to do infaq fi sabili Coles. You'll buy this, you'll see this looks nice, this looks alright, you know, that's tasty, probably, just put it all in, swipe the card at the end, you don't even check the receipt, that's easy to do, because it's here, it's in this life. So, it doesn't take effort to do, or it does take an effort to do for the akhirah. It's a really difficult thing to do. Why? Because, naturally the human being, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ. This is naturally the human being. Allah is saying, you love things immediately. So you know, the food, the entertainment, that'll come right now. You know, you spend for it now, you'll get it right now. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I'm giving you gardens, you know, I'm giving you rivers, and an epic description will come now, later on. I'll give you the gardens, the rivers, the drinks in the paradise. But when? You know, you gotta wait for a long time. It's later on. And so you'll say in the back of your mind, you won't say this on your tongue, but it's in all of us, it's in the back of your mind. You'll say, all right, I'll work for it later because it's gonna come later. Subhanallah, and this is something that goes on in the back of our mind we should get rid of. You know, you think to yourself, how long are you going to live? 60, 70 years, like the Prophet ﷺ says, you'll live in your grave more than you've ever walked on this earth. You'll stay in that stationary position longer than you ever walked on this earth. Yani, work hard. This is the advice in these ayat is, لِسَعْيِهَا. Work hard for the hereafter. And take from this dunya just what you need, just to keep you moving and running. You don't have to compile and pile and pile and pile. You won't even have time to spend it. Just work what you need and just to keep moving and put your efforts for later on for the akhirah. Now another interesting thing in this ayah is that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He begins it and He says, Li sa'yiha. Li sa'yiha, there's a lam. And usually rida, this word, li sa'yiha radiya, usually this rida, it comes with a ba, it doesn't come with a lam. So you all know the hadith, رَضِيْتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّ, right? رَضِيْتُ بِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ. رَضِيَ, you use the word ba, you don't use lam. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says here, لِسَعْيِهَا, and He doesn't say, بِسَعْيِهَا رَضِيَ. That's what we're expecting. So what is some of the benefits of this? Some of the scholars say that this lam is in the meaning of ba, which is a correct opinion. So in other words, with its efforts, it's happy. It's going to be happy. Now, when you say لِسَعْيِهَا, it carries another two rhetorical benefits. And what it implies is that there's something that's mahdoof, and that is لِثَوَابِ سَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةً. In other words, it sees the reward on the Day of Judgment, and then it'll say, I'm so happy I did this. That's one. The other thing is, it will be happy for the opportunity and being given the chance to work for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, they will be happy because Allah gave them the opportunity to serve His deen. They'll be happy because Allah gave them the opportunity to put in this effort. Not just because He gave them the Jannah and He gave them a reward, but because He honored them for being His obedient servants. Yani, in other words, when we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we do good, when we put in effort, When we pray, we give sadaqah, we attend the lesson, we pray at the masjid. It's an honor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. And one of the things, you know, one of the first things we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for is that He gave us the opportunity to be His slaves. So this is the rhetorical benefit of the lamb, is that on the day of judgment, they will be happy and pleased because, not because of the reward that's on one side, but it has another meaning, that Allah gave them the opportunity to worship Him. So in this world, like, you know, you can sort of even think of it, in human experience in this life, when people get a promotion, right? You're below and then you get promoted by your boss and then you get another promotion. You'd like to thank the one that promoted you, you know? I like to thank the CEO forever for promoting me from one position to another. This is in worldly terms they do this. And so this is the same idea happening. You'll be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this promotion He has given you, that He has allowed you to be His servant and His slave. Now keep in mind, you need to keep this in mind, that this Surat Al-Ghashiyah is a Meccan surah. And Meccan time is a time when the Muslims are being humiliated and insulted. When they were giving out the da'wah, they were reading out the Quran, they were being insulted. And Allah is saying, no, you're honored people, you know? And you're going to be pleased, and you are the ones who are going to be relaxed. Right now, Quraysh and the Kuffar, they're relaxed. And you're doing it tough, you know? And you're the ones that are afraid, and you're putting in the hard work and the effort, but the tables later on are going to turn. They're going to be the ones in hardship, and you're the ones that are going to be in relaxation. So now, what does Allah Azza wa Jal have in store for these people that come on the Day of Judgment with a relaxed, fresh face? What does He have in store for them? You know, we found out what He has for the kuffar. Tasla naran hamiyah. There was this fire and then the boiling water and so on. So what does Allah have for these believers? Now an awesome description comes. He says, fi jannatin aliyah, in high gardens. They'll be pleased, and they will be in high gardens. Why is aliyah high mentioned? You know, because when you travel with your family on a road trip, when do you pull over to enjoy the view? You know, when you reach a high place and you can see as far as the eye can see, that's when you'll pull over and that's when you'll go down to enjoy the view. When you go to a hotel as a tourist, what would you like? You know, the top floor or the bottom floor? Of course the top. Why? Because you want to enjoy the view, this long view that the eye can see. So you always take the top. There's something about this aliyah that is instilled within us. And when people go hiking on the mountains and so on, they get to the top of the hill because that's the most beautiful part. That's where you can see everything. After that, you stop, you sit down and you see, you just enjoy the view. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that first, they will be happy with their efforts. Now, there is another pleasure on top of this, and they will be in the high gardens. Now this is a contrast. Compare this to the disbelievers. Firstly, on the Day of Judgment, khashi'ah, they will be fearful. Then they'll be thrown in the fire. Then there's the boiling water. Then there's no food except dari'ah. You know, torture after torture after torture. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us the pleasure after pleasure after pleasure that happens for the believers. So Allah has given us jannatin aliyah. You know, even when you buy property, it's known that the highest properties usually have a higher value due to the good view and the scenery around you. And because it's more or less susceptible to floods and so on. So the higher you go, the more expensive. Now the next pleasure Allah Azza wa Jal gives in the paradise, He says, لا تسمعوا فيها لاغية. You know, subhanAllah, this ayah, it translates to you, meaning Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will not hear inside of these gardens senseless or useless talks and comment. لا تسمعوا. You will not. Now, you know what the interesting thing here is? From the beginning of the surah till now, it has all been in sort of third person. تسقى من عين آنية. It will be given to drink. تسلى. It will be thrown. And then Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't say in this ayah, لا يسمع فيها لاغية. Within the garden, there won't be senseless comments heard. He doesn't say this. He turns and he now directs his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he says to him, you will not hear within these gardens useless talk. You know what we learn from this? Who's the first one that's guaranteed paradise? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because Allah says, لا تسمعوا. You will not. And so this ayah in itself already guarantees that the first person that's guaranteed paradise is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will not hear any nonsense. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will not hear any useless talk. Why is this important to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because when he gives da'wah to this deen, the disbelievers insult him. And they say bad words and disrespectful words and useless speech and comment to him. They say to him, Majnoon, you're insane. You know, they say to him that he's possessed by jinn and shayateen. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that you and your followers won't hear any of this over there. لا تسمعوا فيها لاغية. Now you're going to have to listen to it. But on that day, لا تسمعوا فيها لاغية, you will not hear any of it. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, no bad talk will happen in the paradise. Why? You know, because evil and bad speech always hurts someone. Even if you're in the best of places. How many people, you know, live in beautiful homes and houses? And you think, yani, mashallah, they're living the life. But in reality, you don't know what's happening inside of the house. The marriage life is really bad. And so the husband's saying some really bad words to his wife. And the wife is cursing at the husband and screaming at him. Or then you have grown-up children in the house that are shouting at their parents. That's all level. That's all useless, bad talk. And they have these sad lives, even though they're living in beautiful houses. So a gift in the paradise is that you will not hear no bad speech inside. So now Allah Azza wa Jal has guaranteed fi jannatin aliyah. And now he's telling you that inside of that house, it'll all be good. No one will have a problem with someone else in the house. Because you know, when there are problems in the house, then even if you have the best house in the world, it doesn't matter to you. You know, because inside it's destroyed. So this is the other pleasure Allah guarantees, that inside of the house, it'll be all good. And you know, even in this life, when you want to move to a neighborhood, you always want to move to somewhere where it's peaceful and quiet. You know, you want to move to a neighborhood where there's peace and there's calmness and there's no bad words or swearing words and there's no cars and traffic and people beeping the horn, you know. Or in the street, you don't want to go live in a street where there's people hanging out and drinking and so on. You know, if you go and you feel like you wanted to buy a house or want to move houses, that's the first thing. If your neighbor's a problem, what do? You're not even going to buy there or not rent there. You'll go somewhere else. So Allah is saying, لا تسمعوا فيها لاغية. Guaranteed that your neighborhood in the paradise will be good. You know, it'll be absolutely quiet and peaceful. There's no لاغية in it. There's none of this garbage or useless, senseless comments inside. Now may Allah Azza wa Jal give us a house in that neighborhood. Now he adds to it another pleasure. And he says, فِيهَا عَيْنٌ جَارِيَةٌ. Within it. In other words, within the gardens, there are flowing springs. فِيهَا, in there, inside of the gardens of the paradise. There's عَيْن. عَيْن is a water spring, sort of a fountain, a waterfall. جَارِيَةٌ means it's flowing. So, you're in a high garden with water springs flowing. This means you're on top of the waterfall. And compare this to the people that are scorched in the flames in Jahannam. And they are forced to drink boiling water. And on the other hand, you have the people of the paradise who are living on high gardens, enjoying this beautiful scenery in front of them, that's on top of a spring waterfall with a lot of cool flowing water, and it's always flowing, right? Jariya, non-stop, because it's the noun form. So it alludes to that this will never ever stop. And subhanAllah, even I want you to compare this to human experience in this life. You know, the most expensive hotels in the world today, they will have a swimming pool. And they'll have a water fountain when you first walk into the reception. There's a sort of a waterfall. And there's these simulated waterfalls. And people will be taking pictures right next to it. You know, why do they have all this in very expensive hotels? So they can make the scene seem a bit more exciting and alive. And the people, by nature, they're fascinated. All over the world, they're fascinated by this idea. And everyone wants something like this, a waterfall. And even like when we say the human is fascinated by this idea of fountains and springs, you even find some houses when he's got a really good house and he's built and he's taking care of it, they'll go and buy some artificial waterfall and electricity and turn it on and it just drops water and it keeps going up and down. Because there's humans, they fascinate things like this. They enjoy things like this. And subhanAllah, yani, you know, the Quran, it's been revealed over 1,000 years ago. And still, people have the same interests and are inclined to the same things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. Yani, in other words, my brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is offering us something we run for till this very day. Till this very day. And then Allah says in Surat Al-Mulk, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقْ. Doesn't He know who He created? Yes, of course He knows us. So that's why He offers us things that we are always inclined to and attached to. And then jariya, this river, it's flowing. And if a river is flowing, that means it's fresh. You know, when a river stands, it doesn't flow, it becomes stale. But this is jariya, like jannatin tajri min tahti al-anwar, coming from the same root words, indicating and applying the freshness of these waters. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adds to the pleasure now. So there's the house. It's all good, the neighborhood is quiet, inside the house it's peaceful. You have this waterfall, mashallah, that Allah Azzawajal has placed and decorated in the paradise. And now on top of this, He says, فِيهَا سُرُرٌ مَرْفُوعًا. And within these houses, there are couches and they're raised high. Surur comes from the word sarir. In modern Arabic, sarir means what? A bed. Sarir is a bed. But in ancient Arabic, sarir is a couch. It's a couch. It's sort of a couch you recline and you sit on. And only sort of rich people had this. But I want you to understand the concept of sarir and what it implies. It's very powerful here. You know, in Arabic culture, even until today, whether in Saudi Arabia or in Yemen or in Bahrain or in Kuwait, in Qatar, whatever it is in the Arab lands, they have this culture where they sit on the floor. They sit on the floor. And this culture has been inherited from their forefathers. Back in the times, that's how the forefathers in the Arabian deserts, that's how they used to do. And why were the Arabians, why did they used to sit on the floor? Because part of the lifestyle of the Arab was to move around, to travel a lot. They used to travel a lot from one place to another. And if you had a couch, yeah, and it's going to be hard to move it everywhere you go. You know, imagine you're moving from Lakemba to Greenacre, you've got a couch on your head when you're moving. So, yeah, and because of their lifestyle, they never used to buy couches. There was no couches, just sit on the floor. Part of the lifestyle is to move from here, move there, move over here, move. It's going to be a headache if you had a couch. Now, I want you to understand the idea of the couch. People that were rich and were wealthy, and people that had forts and they lived in houses, they used to buy couches. Because these are people that used to build their house and they didn't have no intention of traveling. So in the Arabian time, when you have a couch, that means it implies stability. You're going nowhere. You're going to move nowhere. That's it. You live here and that's your well-established place and you are located right here. You're going nowhere. And Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Jannah, when He says فِيهَا سُرُرٌ مَرْفُوعًا, what it implies is that He's offering us stability. He's giving us a place to stay forever without the fear of loss. This is the idea of sarir, of a couch. It implies permanency in there forever. Just like the Arab when he used to buy a sarir, it means he's going to remain in the house forever, he's going nowhere. And unlike the furniture of this world, which will go out of fashion and spoil after a while, in the paradise it's different. It remains intact as it is in the same condition and nothing happens to it. Allah Azza wa Jal adds an adjective to this, to these couches. He says, marfu'a. Marfu'a, it's an ism maf'ul. In other words, it's an objective noun. In other words, what that implies is that someone did it for you. These couches that have been elevated, someone elevated the couches. In other words, someone has custom made your couch for you. And in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's engaged in designing your house for you in the Day of Judgment, in the Paradise, and what is within them. This is Allah Azza wa Jal. So when we say marfu'a, who elevated it? Who designed it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Al-Alusi rahimahullah, he comments and he says, why did he elevate them? So you can sit back and see everything you own. You know, subhanallah, just like today, when you have people in high positions, like a judge or like a king, their chair's not down to the earth like this. They got a sort of an elevated chair. And you watch it in movies and sometimes like a king, they have like this sort of elevated couch so you can see everyone. And the judge, when he sits in the courtroom, he's not sitting with everyone else, he's right above. So Allah Azza wa Jal has honored these people and now He's giving them surur marfu'a, they're elevated. And Al-Alusi, he says, they're elevated and they're done so you can see everything you own. And subhanAllah, even in interior design, what do they teach? They teach that when you decorate your house and you have a couch, make sure you place the couch facing the hallway, right, so you can see everything. Otherwise, if you turn it and it doesn't have a full view, then you know you're missing a lot from the house or you're missing a lot from the view. So they teach, put the couch so it can sort of have this view towards the hallway so you can see as far as the eye can see. And so Allah Azza wa Jal has already placed this in subhanAllah. These are things that people speak of today that Allah spoke of thousands of years ago. Fiha sururun marfu'a. Now Allah Azza wa Jal, he continues. And you know, just like the tennis, the umpire, he sits up the top so he can see everything. He's elevated. Same idea. But of course, this in the paradise, it cannot be compared to anything. You can just sort of have a rough sketch of what's going on. Now there are three more ayat before we conclude. And this is still describing this pleasure Allah Azza wa Jal gives the believers. The other one, he says, وَأَكْوَابٌ مَوْضُوعَ. So now you're in this high house, you're on top of the waterfall, it's all peaceful, it's quiet. There's these couches that are elevated, you're sitting, you're viewing, you know, enjoying the view. And then there's this akwab on mawdu'a. Akwab comes from the word kub. Akwab is plural, so there's more than one cup. And kub means a cup. And in Arabic it refers to a large, huge, big cup that doesn't have a handle, and it's thin and slender from the middle neck, and then it's wide from the top, like a champagne bottle, for example, or champagne glass, for example. This is akwab. That's what akwab refers to. And akwab, back in history, it used to be sort of ascribed to holding exotic fresh drinks. So when you say akwab, then there's something very expensive inside of it. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, what's happening with these akwab? They're mawdu'a, another objective now. In other words, they have already been placed. So you come in, you sit on the couch, and your dining table has already been set for you. Mawdu'a also comes from the word wada'a. And you know the word tawadu'a. Tawadu'a means what? Humility, humbleness, you know, something lowered. In other words, these cups will be there, and they're lowered for you. And a servant, the children of the paradise, they will come and they will lower the glass for you and they'll put it right beneath or in front of you. Wa akwabun mawdu'a. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, He didn't say wa akwabun tuwda'a. That was the verb. Had He said tuwda'a, then it would have meant that the glass will be placed down once. But mawdu'a, because it's a noun, then it implies that when you drink from it, another cup is placed. And you drink from it, another cup is placed. And another one, continuously, mawdu'a. You know, like jariya, continuously. Mawdu'a, continuous. Marfu'a, it's continually, it will never come down. This is the noun and this is what it implies. And subhanAllah, even this happens today in expensive restaurants. You have the idea of refill. But the difference is that at the end you get charged for it. There's an expensive bill that comes your way. Whereas everything in the paradise, everything in Jannah, because of your efforts to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so He has given you this endless reward that's for free. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَنَمَارِقُ مَصْفُوفَةً. Namariq refers to small pillows, right? According to some dictionaries, namariq is their small pillows. So that small pillow, you know, you might want to put on your high couch for even extra comfort. You know, small pillows. And like now, you sit on the couch, you get the pillow, you put it behind you on your side, and what for? For extra comfort. So there's namariqu masfufa, Allah is saying. There will be these small pillows for extra comfort. And then He says masfufa. Masfufa, in other words, rows upon rows upon rows of pillows. Lots of pillows. Everywhere you look, you find relaxation. Because a pillow is always ascribed to the notion or the idea of comfort and relaxation. So when He says mawdu'a, masfufa, it gives you this idea of there's just relaxation upon relaxation wherever you look. And then He says, وَزَرَابِيُّ مَبْثُوثَةٌ. Zarabi, this is يعني expensive, elegant rugs. A zarabi is a rug, not carpet rugs. It's different because a carpet sort of is cheap. But the rug, like Al-Farra'i rahimahullah, he says that al-zarabi are expensive rugs made of delicate fibers, like the velvet and the, you know, one piece $500-$600. But that's here. But in the paradise, Allahu a'lam what Allah Azza wa Jalla has in store. And even nowadays, these exotic rugs are an expensive market, which people, you know, who have mansions and so on, they buy for their living room or for their office, you know, to make it look good. These are the zarabi. Not anyone, like me and you, we don't buy zarabi. Then He says, وَزَرَابِيُّ مَبْثُوثَةٌ. Mabthuthah, this is the adjective of these rugs. What does mabthuthah mean? It's spread as far as the eye can see. In other words, you have these cushions and you have these rugs as far as you can see. In other words, what? How big is the living room? It's huge because Allah is saying mabthuthah is just spread out as far as you can see. For subhanAllah, يعني, just taking these ayat and this description of the paradise, one can conclude that Allah Azza wa Jal is giving the people, or is giving us, as we said, something that Bani Adam, that human beings, run after till this very day and throughout human history. That's the same thing everyone runs for. When you tell someone, Yaqi, what are you running towards? Wallah, I want to buy a house, and then I want to fix the house, and then I want to have this and have that, and buy this inside, and fix it up from here. But subhanAllah, يعني Allah Azza wa Jal, when He speaks in the Quran, He speaks logic to us. He speaks something that connects with your brain and with your mind. Which house do you want? You want here, or you want to take up my offer, and I guarantee you that. You know, now it goes back to you, لِسَعْيِهَا رَضِيَةً. How much sa'i can you do for this? And so we ask at the end, Allah Azza wa Jal, we ask Him that He gives us a place in the paradise. Inshallah ta'ala, next week we'll continue. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. It's very important to understand these ayat. And what does the ibil, the camel, what does the camel have to do here now? All of a sudden there's a shift of subject. And we mentioned before how Allah spoke about dari'a, and we said dari'a is the food of the camel that it eats in the desert. And then the ayat, the way Allah Azza wa Jalla says, كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ, how it was created. Not مِمَّا خُلِقَتْ, from what it was created. And that came before in Surat Al-Tariq. Inshallah, these things will be shared in the next week, bi-ithnillah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us students of the Qur'an, people who benefit from the reminders of the Qur'an. Before we conclude, is there any questions someone might ask in relation to the lesson? طيب. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.